types and categories of stress. So we also are required to know what are the types of stress as a suprasegmental feature, and then what are the categories of stress, right? How can we describe a stress at word level, at lexical level, and then how can we just interpret it in terms of our, broader level interpretation of stress is a suprasegmental aspect of speech, right? So the types of stress, we have two main types, the primary stress and then the secondary stress, right? There is one more type of stress, the tertiary stress, but most of the time we are concerned with the primary stress and the secondary stress. Primary stress is, since it's the, basic level stress, and it has the ability to change the meaning of stress, so we would be more concerned with the primary stress. And secondary stress is just in order to make the pronunciation of a longer word more appropriate. So for that purpose, we need to know what is secondary stress. And the tertiary stress is basically the weak stress, right? So these are the types of stress, and the major ones are primary and secondary. In two syllabic words, we are required to make one prominent in language like English, right? That is for the sake of the alteration of meaning, right? Because if the first syllable is stressed, then the meaning would be different. And if the second is stressed, then the meaning would be changed, right? Like, for example, the noun insult, that's the noun, an adjective, right? But when it is a verb, then it would become like insult, to insult, right? So that's the difference, because the category is changed, and that's the phonemic level stress variation, right? So for that purpose, the primary stress is important. And in long words, when one syllable is primarily stressed, we can have one, and if the word is exceptionally long, then we can also have two or more than two secondary stresses, right? And those are for the sake of, better appropriate pronunciation. Right, so that's relevant to the pronunciation of a word, right? Or the representation of a typical dialect of a language, right? If you just, for the sake of interest, look at the history of stress, that's an important discussion, right? In English, and in Old English, basically, in Old English, words used to be monosyllabic, most of the words. Most of the words were monosyllabic, right? And you know that within monosyllabic words, we are not really concerned with the stress, right? And we do not differentiate between the types of stress in monosyllabic, because there is only one syllable, right? But in, the polysyllabic words, if there were a few in English, then the pattern was that the first syllable was stress, right? And that was the system. And if only one exception was there, if there was some prefix in the beginning of that word, then the stress was automatically shifted to the second syllable, right? So that was very simple pattern in English, right? But then when English as a language grew up and it borrowed words from other languages, then the stress pattern was disturbed. And we, started to have this, the current, description of syllables, right? Because then we were required to go in, see the distribution of stress in various types of words, since English then became a language having borrowed words from various languages, right? Like the Anglo-Saxon Old English, and then also from German language, from other languages, and it borrowed from Latin as well, and Roman words were there, French words were there. So the pattern of stress disturbed the language. And the description of stress is that we have, the acute accent, right, for the primary stress, and then also the grave accent, right? And for the primary stress, we just place it above the symbol, right, above the syllable, before the start of the stress syllable. And for secondary, that is below the syllable, right? So that's the main difference. In word like apple, right, so the A, before the A, since the first syllable is stressed, so before the A, we have the syllabic diacritic. And the word morphology is really important in order to determine the stress pattern within English and similar languages, right? Like, for example, if it's a monosyllabic word, then does not actually make a difference, right? Because then the stress is something which is applied on more than one syllable word, right? Then for bi or disyllabic words, we are to be very careful because that changes the category of the word, the grammatical category of the word. And then within multisyllabic words, we are also required to be careful specifically for the placement of the primary stress pattern, right? Like the difference, present and present. Present, present. See the difference, and that's an important discussion, an important distinction between the two types of words, right? And then within multisyllabic words, the long words, the compound words, we are required to be careful about not only the primary stress, but also about the secondary stress. Let me show you a table, and you would have this idea more clearly that how important it is, right? This is the table, and if you see that the word type is very important, that what type of word it is, right? Like two-syllabic, bisyllabic, or disyllabic words, and the category of the word, that whether it is a noun or a verb, that is important. If it's a noun, then the first syllable is stressed, like center, object, flower, right? But if this is a verb, then the second syllable is stressed. You see the red color. The red color is there. Release, admit, arrange. See the difference. And then within compound words, the nouns and adjectives, right? They are in words like desktop, pencil case, bookshelf, greenhouse, right? So the first part of the word is made stressed. And for adjectives and verbs, right, the last part of the verb in compound words like well-meant, right, hard-headed, old-fashioned, understand, overlook, outperform, you see, the last. So that's the main difference, and we should also keep in mind that what's the type of the word and what's the category and how the stress pattern is realized.